Welcome to Horological History, where we talk about the history of horology that I've read from somewhere and retained a little bit of information through the process of osmosis. It's going to be a bit of fact sprinkled with a little bit of fiction, because not all books are right and I'm mostly wrong. So if any of these topics interest you, I encourage you to go out and dig a little deeper to quench your horological thirst so you can one-up your watch collector friends. This episode, we're diving deep into the life of an amazing watchmaker. But before we get our big toe wet, let's just quickly talk about astronomical watches. When you hear astronomical watches, you may think of Jacob & Co., Michael the Producer, Christian van der Klaw, Van Cleef Arpels, and Bovet. These watches don't just display the time here on Earth, they show constellation, moon phases, equation of time, solar eclipses, sidereal time, how the Earth interacts with the universe, all on your wrist or in the palm of your hand. Name another device that does that. Mechanically, all the amazing mechanism that are used in watches today and Haute Horology, these inventions came from a time, an era where this man was born. And we're going to cast our minds back to just over 272 years ago, where George Margetts was born in 1748 in Woodstock, Oxfordshire, England. Margetts was one of several siblings, and his father died when he was 14. And by 16, he had an apprenticeship with a clockmaker in Oxfordshire. Soon after, he moved to London, where he was no Joe Blow clockmaker. Margetts was in an elite group of watch and clockmakers who focused on precision timekeeping and in the race to solve the problem of longitude. In Margetts' lifetime, he produced amazing clocks, astronomical clocks and watches, marine chronometers, and mechanical calculating instruments. The man was a beast, and by the time he was 30, he was already producing these amazing astronomical watches from his new residence in 3 Cheapside, London. People were savages. Cheapside? Margetts was making this masterpiece, a horological home run hitter, and the movement was only 46.7 mils in diameter. That's only 10 mils larger than an ETA 6498, dude. George didn't muck around. These things were powered by fusion chain, straight line power to the escapement, where he either used verge or cylinder in different models. The brass plates were gilded. Amazing engraver, eagle neck regulator, and of course, the diamond end stone. And truth be told, that's not even the best bit. Flip it over and we see the amazing white enamel dial. Shows the positions of the sun and the moon in the zodiac throughout the years. The stars visible each night, the age of the moon, and the times of high tide at various ports around Great Britain. London, Hull, Portish, Dublin. The whole dial rotates clockwise once per day, together with the solar and lunar indicators, but over the course of a year, both solar and lunar hands regress at different rates to show the position of the sun and the moon in the zodiac. Effectively, the dial rotates once per every sidereal day. That's 23 hours, 56 minutes, and 4 seconds. And the solar and lunar hands rotate once in a solar and lunar day. The gold horizon ring and the white central enamel dial are the only things that don't move. Oh, and that little central white enamel dial? That's the minutes and hours hand that tell you the time. And it does all this with only 16 gears. However, when Margetts was 40, he had to file for bankruptcy in 1788. Some say it was his obsession with longitude. A year later, in 1789, Margetts presented his detached pendulum to the Board of Longitude, where he was not successful at all. Later that year, he approached the Board of Longitude again, desperate, this time with his mathematical table to assist with navigation of sailing ships. But again, the board saw no value. However, in 1790, the East India Trading Company did see value in Margetts' tables, and they bought 40 of them to assist with navigation. As I said, Margetts lived in an amazing horological time period. And of course, in that period lived the watchmaking god Thomas Mudge, who is the inventor, the father of the lever escapement, arguably one of the greatest horological inventions. And Mudge, he only made a couple of watches with this escapement. He later put his focus in marine chronometers using amazing, innovative verge escapements. Margetts, he was a beast of a watchmaker, and Mudge saw this and gave him his holy communion when it showed him his lever escapement design. Margetts later made several watches and with the lever escapement and even made improvements on Mudge's original design. Here is an example of a watch Margetts made in 1798 with the lever escapement. There's three separate dials, one indicating hours, the other minutes, the other seconds. Three-arm bimetallic balance wheel, straight-line lever escapement, flat balance spring, and of course, diamond end stone. It wasn't many years after this watch was made that we come to the end of Margetts' story. It gets a bit vague on the exact year. Some sources say it's 1804, some say it's 1808. Either way, it was an unfortunate and untimely death. Margetts was a legendary watchmaker. He left an amazing legacy of horological machines behind for people to awe and envy over 200 years later. After his death, only a few watchmakers would use the lever escapement in watches for almost a quarter of a century. One of those watches was none other than Abraham Louis Breguet. I hope you enjoyed this episode of Horological Histories. Hit that like button, hit the subscribe, hit that notification bell so you can see next week's episode.